So it's time to start counting the number of operations required for Gaussian elimination. That's what I'll do in this video. In the next video, we'll consider what forward and backward substitution would take. So for Gaussian elimination, we need these identities. These are ones that you probably have seen before. The sum of n1s will just be n. The sum of k equals 1 to n of k, which is 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 up to n, is this 1 half n, n plus 1, very famous identity made famous by Gauss as a primary school kid. Or the sum from k equals 1 to n of k squared is a little bit more complicated. I think it's worthwhile to derive these things. I ask you to do them as reading problems. Okay, so let's look at Gaussian elimination. So I want to look at one step in the Gaussian elimination. So what does that mean? So we have our matrix, n by n matrix, say, or we can have an augmented matrix. But let's consider n by n. And then we have our pivot. So this is our diagonal. And then we have a pivot here somewhere. Okay, so let's say that's the pivot. So this is a n by n matrix, n by n. Okay. So what do we need to do then in Gaussian elimination in this step? We have how many elements to the right of the pivot? Here we have, it depends where this pivot is, right? So this pivot, let's say, is in the I position, the I row, and the I column, okay? I row, I column. This is a n by n matrix, so we have n minus I elements to the right of this pivot. How many rows underneath this pivot do we have? We also have n minus I rows. So the Gaussian elimination procedure multiplies the pivot by a constant, or multiplies this row by a constant, and starts adding it to the rows underneath. So the elements exactly underneath the pivot are all zero. So we know that. We don't have to do any computation. But what we have to do is we have to multiply every element to the right of the pivot by a constant. That's n minus I multiplications, and then add it to the row underneath. That's one row underneath. Then multiply again by another constant, add it to the next row underneath. That will be another n minus I additions. So for this one procedure, then, we have n minus I times n minus I, or n minus I squared, multiplications and additions, okay? So that's finding the constant from the pivot, multiplying by the constant, adding it to the row underneath, finding the other constant, multiplying everything by that constant, adding it to the row underneath. So we have basically n minus I squared multiplications and additions. But we have to do that for all the pivots. We have to do that for the first pivot, the second pivot, all the way down to almost the bottom. The last row we don't have to do that for. So we have to do that for n minus 1 pivots. So we can write the total number of operations. That means additions and multiplications, is equal to the sum from I equals 1 to n minus 1 of n minus I squared. Okay, so that covers the entire matrix and all the pivots. What is this thing? This doesn't quite match our formula, but if we just look at the first few terms in this sum, we have an n minus 1 squared, and then I equals 2 is an n minus 2 squared, And then we go all the way to n minus 1. So n minus n plus 1 goes to 1 squared. So this is just 1 squared plus 2 squared plus 3 squared all the way to the n minus 1 squared. So we can rewrite that as the sum from k equals 1 to n minus 1 of k squared. Now we match our third formula here. So that's simply 1/6 times the upper limit. Here it's n, here it's n minus 1. Here it's 2n plus 1. So that becomes 2n minus 2 plus 1, or 2n minus 1. And here it's n plus 1, so that becomes n. Okay? And then the leading order term is what interests us. That would be the n cubed term. So we have n times 2n times n, so 2n cubed divided by 6. So that works out to 1/3 n cubed plus things that are smaller, proportional to n squared or proportional to n. And using our big O notation, that's just big O of n cubed. Okay? Gaussian elimination, the forming of the LU matrix, right? That's Gaussian elimination, scales like n cubed. What that means is that if you double the matrix size, it will take you 8 times as long. Okay? What I want to show you then is that forward and backward substitution scale like n squared rather than n cubed, so that when n is really large, it requires order n fewer CPU time, much, much faster. So if n is like, you know, in the thousands, it should turn out to be thousands times faster. Okay, let me summarize. I'm trying to show you what the type of work one has to do to count the number of operations in a somewhat sophisticated problem. The problem here is Gaussian elimination, which is basically finding the LU decomposition of a matrix. So I show you that when you're in the ith stage of the process to do Gaussian elimination using the pivot in the ith row and the ith column takes about n minus I squared multiplications and additions. Okay? I didn't include the extra work required to find the factor, but it's kind of inconsequential. And then we have to sum over all of the rows. So we sum from I equals 1 to n minus 1 of n minus I squared. We use the summation formula, and we get the leading order term, which is 1/3 n cubed. In terms of scaling, the consequential piece is that it's big O n cubed. Double the size of the matrix, the computation will take 8 times longer. Next video, we'll look at forward and backward substitution so I can convince you that the LU decomposition is worthwhile when you have multiple right-hand sides. I'm Jeff Chasnov. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.